Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder in Christmas River, a Christmas cozy mystery by Meg Muldoon, narrated by Randye Kaye. Prologue. He went back to the scene of it all, deep into the woods, the place where his journey had started. The dog hadn't liked the tone of the woman's voice. There was something desperate in it, something shrill and bad, something ominous. His hair bristled. He felt like growling, lifting his lips and revealing his sharp teeth, but he knew it would only be met by a scold and some yelling from his owner. This was an odd place they were in. The dog had been here before, but each time it felt new and strange. The ground was cold against his paws, and white pieces of cold fell from the sky sometimes, getting in his eyes and making his fur damp and heavy. The dog was used to warmer weather. His master raised his voice, his thunderous sound echoing against the trees in the woods. The dog dug his claws into the snow. Sounds he couldn't understand came out of his owner's mouth. Then there was movement, fast movement. The dog readied for attack. His owner grabbed the woman's arm. There was a struggle. The dog lunged for the woman's leg. She screamed out. There was the sound of steel going into flesh. The dog dug his teeth deeper into the leg, tasting blood and salt. His master crumbled to the ground, a coppery smell filling the air. The dog felt a stiff kick to his ribcage that sent him flying back. The woman ran. The dog ran after her, nipping at her heels. She carried his owner's smell with her. But then she reached a car, and the dog could only bark at her, snarling his teeth as the car backed up and peeled away from the trail parking lot. The dog didn't have to go back into the woods to know his owner was dead, but he did. He stood over the body as white flakes fell from the sky and clung to his owner's lifeless body. He watched as it accumulated. He barked, but his cries were muffled and carried away by the sharp winds. No one else came. The dog was alone. Chapter 1. I'm not sentimental. I'm not sappy or soft or gooey. In the spring, when Girl Scouts come to my business looking to sell me some overpriced Thin Mints, I send them packing. In the fall, when all the ladies of Christmas River start planning the annual Christmas parade, I can be found back at my pie shop working hard on getting the seasonal Christmas pie just right. That, or I can be found drinking down at the Pine Needle Tavern with two old-timers who like to recount the glory days of Christmas River before the lumber mill shut down. During the annual Christmas River Gingerbread Junction Competition held every year the second week of December, I take no prisoners. I aim to kill, and I shoot to win. That's me. My name is Cinnamon, and my mom had some foresight on her when she named me that. She knew that I had a kick to me. No, sentimental isn't normally something I identify with. But something about that dog out there, with his matted fur all thick with snowflakes, and the way he's shivering and shaking in that cutting Central Oregon Cascade Mountains kind of wind, and the way that he bolts every time I so much as go for the doorknob, and the fear and sadness in his little eyes, looking like somebody did something bad to him, looking like the way I did about 2 years ago. Something about him has turned me into a big bowl of hot pie filling, oozing and bubbling over the sides of the pan, all melted and gooey and sweet. Jeez, I've even got a name I'm calling him now, Huckleberry. I watched him as he slopped away noisily at the almost empty tin pie pan while keeping his fearful eyes glued on me. He couldn't even really enjoy the leftover pie like that, ready to jump if I so much moved from my statue-like stance at the back door window. The snow was coming down in heavy flakes, standing out against the dog's black fur. It probably had been lustrous at one point, the way Australian shepherd's fur usually is. Now it was all matted and muddy. Tear stains clung to the corners of his sad little eyes, a desperation of hunger in them. He had a thin red collar around his neck, but no tag. I hated thinking about how his little stomach must have grumbled. He could have been a poster dog for one of those Humane Society commercials with words at the bottom of the screen saying something like, "When will my next meal be?" Poor thing. This was the third time this week he'd come to the back porch of my pie shop. He came out of the woods that bordered the back of my store. I didn't know if it was the bright light shining through the black night that brought him, or the smell of late-night pastries and the promise of scraps. But for whatever reason, he'd show up on my back porch. When it first happened, I opened the door and tried to lure him inside with some leftover marionberry pie. He took off back into the woods, but an hour later, he was right back there, shivering on the steps. I finally left a pie tin of scraps on the porch for him to eat in his own good time. And as I watched him nervously devour the leftovers, I gave him a name. Huckleberry. It really should have been Marionberry, but that sounded too much like a girl's name. The dog was a boy dog and needed a stronger name, Huckleberry. The next morning, I called the sheriff's office about the stray, but either nobody had any luck catching him, or catching a lost dog wasn't high on anybody's priority list. Since then, he'd visited the back porch a couple more times, each time late at night, each time when nobody could catch him, each time I'd leave a tin of the day's leftover pie for him, each night I'd watch him eat, and he'd watch me. I wanted to help him more, but he wouldn't let me. I looked out the window and fought off a chill that traveled up my spine, a bitter winter's chill that had stayed with me for the past 2 years. Sometimes it would just strike me out of nowhere. In the height of a summer day, I'd be hit with a bout of shivers. My body would go numb, and it was like I'd get caught in a thick fog for a while. I never had the chills up until 2 years ago. Huckleberry suddenly stopped slopping at the tin. His ears pricked up and his hair bristled, and within a split second he was gone. I watched him run back into the woods, disappearing into the darkness. I stared out into those black, frozen woods as the chills overpowered me. I wasn't sentimental, but that didn't mean I didn't sometimes fall back into my own memories on dark, vacuous nights like tonight. Me and Huckleberry, each in our own darkness. I didn't feel warm again until the next morning. Chapter 2. Christmas River, where the Christmas spirit never dies. That's on the cheerful welcome sign when you drive through Christmas River. Beneath it, it lists the population, 5,030. It doesn't say the truth, which is that the town died a long time ago. The real town, at least. The town was named after the crystal clean river it was built around. But when the lumber mill shut down 30 years ago, things changed. A lot. Christmas ornament shops suddenly started springing up. Gift shops and coffee huts and art galleries weren't far behind. They put in an ice rink in the lumber mill parking lot. In a scramble to keep from dying, the town milked its name for all it was worth. Soon, Christmas River wasn't just a town to drive through. It became a primary pit stop, a destination that people across the state would come to for a little bit of manufactured Christmas cheer year-round. I'm 33, but I know what the town once was. My grandfather has enough stories in him about the way things used to be to write a book the size of War and Peace. He talks about the way Christmas River used to be populated by blue-collar workers, working hard to support their families and make ends meet. Good people, not the casual, spoiled tourists that now outweighed the real residents most days of the year. My hometown has become a novelty, a place of forced smiles and customer satisfaction, of little old ladies dressing up as Mrs. Claus and trying to sell you something, of capitalizing and merchandising the magic of the season year-round. My grandfather says it's practically unrecognizable these days. But what's bad is what's good sometimes. The trees aren't complaining and I'm not either. The town's reinvented facade is part of the reason why my pie shop, Cinnamon's Pies, has done so well. It's a lot of the reason why I can live back here and help take care of my grandfather. Plus, I'm not all gloom and doom when it comes to Christmas. I do enjoy some things about the holiday, like perfecting my seasonal edition of Cinnamon's Christmas Pie, or helping my neighbor's kids build their first snow fort of the season, or lighting candles in windows during December blizzards, or the annual Christmas River Gingerbread Junction Competition held the second week of December every year, especially the Gingerbread Junction Competition. The grand prize is a 4-day trip to Maui. But it's not even about the trip to Maui. There's much more at stake than tropical palm trees, warm waters, and Mai Tai cocktails. It's about the title, to be known as the Junction Queen, to be recognized as more creative, crafty, and clever than anybody else that year. I started participating in the competition when I was 15. When I was 17, I got my first win. There were a few years I missed while I was away at college, but ever since I was 23, I've been in every single gingerbread house competition. That's 10 years of straight competitions. Every year, people come from all over the Northwest to ogle the gingerbread art we create. Some of the competitors spend all year preparing for it, creating blueprint after blueprint for epic cookie houses with intricate decorations. For some of us, it becomes an obsession. Or maybe that's just me. The past 2 years, I've become particularly obsessed with creating the grandest gingerbread house the world has ever seen. I've won 5 competitions altogether and come in second place most of the other times, except for 2 years ago when I bombed out of the competition completely. It ended in a week-long depression-driven pie binge where each night I'd go home, drink glass after glass of white wine, and eat leftover pie, and sob while watching the late-night soul music infomercials. There were obviously other reasons for my meltdown, but the loss and utter humiliation of not even placing in the competition really killed me. But I was determined to redeem myself from that experience. This year, I was determined to show everyone that I was back. I wanted to show them that I couldn't be beaten so easily, that I wasn't a has-been, that I could still create works of art through sugar, flour, and spices. I had to prove to them that I was a winner. If only my gingerbread house-building partner was as focused. Next thing I knew, he was looking at me with this absolutely horrified expression on his face. I can't even describe it, Sin. The kind of pain the man must have been in. I mean, the coffee spilled all over him, she said. And the most horrible thing about it all was that for some reason, I just wanted to start giggling. I mean, I just had the worst time containing myself. Kara's face broke out into a smile, revealing 2 perfectly straight rows of perfect white teeth. I shook my head, hunching over the first story of the gingerbread mansion we were working on. I can't believe you, I said. I know, I can't believe myself either sometimes, she said. She was still smiling. There ought to be a law against me. We were in the back of the pie shop. It was late afternoon, a time of the day that rarely saw visitors. We were in the kitchen working on the first step in the week-long process of building an elaborate, award-winning gingerbread house. Well, at least one of us was working. Kara was talking more shop than slaving away, but that was okay. It was going to be a long evening. Kara had been my best friend since high school. She was a platinum blonde who, true to her hair color, had a lot of spark and tenacity. She was loud and abrasive and acted like a bull in a china shop sometimes. But despite her general noisiness, Kara had a deep love for crafting and was a hard worker. Her store, Ornate Ornaments, did well, especially during the winter and summer tourist seasons. People would buy ornaments in Christmas River even when it wasn't Christmas. She was a smart businesswoman. Even though we'd been best friends for a long time, it wasn't always that way. When I moved away from Christmas River to go to college, we lost touch. It wasn't until I moved back 5 years ago to take care of my grandpa and set up shop that we started talking again. I never completely understood why Kara had never left Central Oregon. She always seemed like she was made for a big city, But Kara had never gotten much farther than Farewell, a town 30 minutes west that was about 3 times the size of Christmas River. She had met and married a man out there and moved there for him. But 4 years into the marriage, things fell apart. And when they did, Kara came back home to this side of the mountains and opened up her ornament shop. We were similar in that way. We both knew what it was like to have the rug ripped out from underneath us, to have it all fall apart. "Well, are you going to see him again?" I asked, "or are you going to let the poor man die of shame?" Since her divorce, Kara had been going through what seemed like hundreds of dates. She must have dated just about every eligible bachelor in Christmas River and the surrounding towns. Nothing ever seemed to work out, though, but her dates did always make for good stories. Part of me wondered if Kara wasn't just going through the motions of it, and that she was still hung up on her ex. She was likable enough, and despite what she wanted it to seem like sometimes, she did have heart. She was pretty, too. Kara could easily have had just about any of those eligible bachelors if she really wanted to. "I seriously don't know if I'll get that image out of my head," she said. "I mean, I can try, but I just know, knowing me, that sometime he'll be talking to me about something serious, and it's going to pop back in my head, and I'll start laughing." I shook my head again disapprovingly. "You can't build a relationship with that kind of starting point, can you?" she continued. "Sometimes you just have to quit while you're ahead, you know what I mean?" "But what if he's a really nice guy?" I asked, while gluing together the walls of the main floor grand entrance with powdered sugar frosting. "What if he's your soulmate, and he had one bad moment where he lost his grip on his mug? You can't hold that against him, can you?" "All's fair in love and war, which includes dropping a guy because he spilled coffee all over himself on your first date," Kara said, shrugging. "Anyway, I've stopped believing in soulmates. Mine's been way overdue for too long. I'm beginning to think he's forgotten about me." Kara tossed a used-up pastry bag into the trash can, like she was tossing out Craig Canby's hopes at a second date with her as well. "Don't give me that look, Cinnamon," she said, catching my gaze at the sad pastry bag in the trash can. "I'm not as heartless as all that, and you know it. But sadly, we can't all find doctors to ride off into the sunset with like you." I let out a long sigh and looked up at her. "Let's not go there," I said. "I've got enough on my mind as is." "You never want to go there," she said. "And I'm your best friend. If you can't talk about it with me, then with who?" "There's nothing to talk about," I said. "We're just friends." Kara gave me a look, one of those looks I'd become familiar with in our many years of being friends, the kind of "I smell bullcrap and I'm calling you on it" look. "You're dead wrong," I said. "Well, he goes to your pie shop for lunch every afternoon," she said. "I've got enough sense in that department to know that he's not just being friendly." I started building the support beams of the second floor, feeling like the kitchen was getting stuffy. "What can I say?" I said. "I make a mean pie. I've got a lot of repeat customers." "Get out of town," Kara said, rolling her eyes. "As good as the pie is, you know that ain't it." I suddenly wanted to change the subject. Mostly because whenever Tara tried to talk about Dr. John Billings with me, I'd be struck by this wave of confusion mixed in with a little guilt. John first started coming into the shop about a year ago. Soon he was there every afternoon at exactly noon. Every day he'd order a slice of the strawberry rhubarb pie, but he'd never finish the slice. After a few months, I started putting together the fact that John didn't really like pie and that there were other reasons he was there. He wasn't a bad sort. He was in his early 40s and had once been married a long time ago, but was now divorced. He moved to Christmas River about 5 years earlier from Boise to start up his own podiatrist practice. He was smart and good-looking by most standards, and he did a lot of pro bono work in the community. Like I said, he wasn't a bad sort, but sometimes you just know when something isn't going to work out. I wasn't right for him. I felt it in my bones, and he wasn't right for me. But sometimes I wondered if I was approaching the situation with a closed mind. I was getting older, that was a fact. Plus, he was a nice man, that kind of love that they always talk about, the one that sweeps you off your feet and makes you feel drunk and dizzy and obsessed all the time. I'd been there before. I'd known a love like that before. And I knew that those kinds of love only ever ended badly. I knew what kind of a monster love like that could turn you into. Sometimes I wondered if maybe someone like John was just who I needed, someone who was steadier and calmer, someone who I could grow to love, maybe. Maybe that's what mature love was. Maybe that was the kind of love that really lasted forever. I was undecided about John, and in the meantime, it just felt like I was leading him on. He sat there ordering slice after slice of pie that he didn't even like, while I just took his money and made it seem like he had a chance with me. "I guess we're not as young as we used to be," Kara said, echoing my own thoughts. "No more Billy Sanders or Kevin Rhines or Daniel Brightmans to serenade us these days. It's not like high school anymore." I laughed, remembering those three boys from high school, but soon felt a wave of chills run up and down my back. I didn't like to think about getting older any more than she did, but we weren't that old. "You make it sound like we're fossils," I said. She sighed. "Well, lately I've been feeling like one," she said. "Living in a small town doesn't help any." A shadow passed over her face. "Come on," I said, refilling a pastry bag with more frosting sealant. "Fossils wouldn't be able to take Gretchen O'Malley to the floor the way we're going to this weekend, so cheer up." That made her laugh. Gretchen O'Malley was our gingerbread competition arch nemesis. She was a retired, nasty woman who was the reigning queen of the competition. I couldn't prove it, but I was pretty sure that when she wasn't scaring children or collecting toadstools and dead ravens for a potion, she spent all her time in the kitchen, working on her gingerbread house. Gretchen was good at the competition, but we were going to be better this year. "You're right," she said. "We're going to make her wish that she never picked up a spatula." I smiled. The bell on the front door jingled, and I put down the pastry bag to go help the late afternoon customer. Kara smiled as I walked away, but I had a feeling it didn't last too long. It was hard getting older. It was hard being single and getting older. It was something I didn't like to think about when I could avoid it. Chapter 3. After I closed the pie shop, I walked on over to the Pine Needle Tavern. The streets had been icy the night before, but now a fine dust of snow settled over the concrete and asphalt. I passed Gretchen O'Malley by coincidence as I walked there. She was strolling down the street, wearing some sort of fur jacket with giant gold earrings. Her arm was hooked with her husband's. Gretchen's husband was a stout, bald man who would yell things to the judges when they were taking notes on our gingerbread houses. Gretchen would give him angry glances every once in a while in response. I didn't know the ins and outs of their marriage, but I got the feeling that Gretchen was the one who wore the pants in their relationship. I nodded as we passed on the street, but she pretended not to see me, keeping her nose high in the air. I swear the woman would drown if a rainstorm hit. Gretchen was a piece of work, all right, but she didn't have to say hi to me. She'd hear me loud and clear soon enough. She wouldn't be able to ignore me then. I walked on, picking up the pace. It was a dark winter's night, and I could feel the chills coming on. I pulled my down jacket tighter around me. All the storefronts were brightly lit with old-fashioned red and green bulbs, trying to instill the holiday spirit. The longer I lived here, the more immune I became to that spirit. It made me sad. I didn't want to be bitter about Christmas or holiday cheer, but maybe that's what happens when you live in a town where it's Christmas year-round. Christmas just doesn't mean the same. Or at least, it hadn't for the past 2 years. I pushed on the heavy doors of the tavern and was treated with a burst of warm, fermented air. I made my way to the bar at the back, the place I knew Warren would be. "Hey there, Sin," Harold said, catching my eye from behind the bar. "What can I get you?"
Nothing for me tonight," I said. "I've got some more work to do back at the shop. I'm just here for the old man."
"The clock struck 12, boys," Warren said from his crowded table, taking a long drink from his pint of beer.
I wondered how many that was for him. He was drinking more lately, and he really shouldn't have been. I was pretty sure his doctor would have been harassing me if she found out how much Warren was drinking. but I knew that coming down to the tavern, drinking with the boys, and reminiscing about the old days at the lumber mill was one of the things that kept him going. "How's the shop these days, Cinnamon?" Larry, my grandfather's best friend of nearly 55 years, asked. "It's been a good season so far," I said. "How's Sheila? Is she ready for the Gingerbread Junction?"
"The house has smelled like gingerbread for days," Larry said, rubbing his wrinkled face and sighing.
"And that's a bad thing?" I asked.
"It's been torture. The woman won't let me even try any of it, I swear. I feel like she's watching me all the time, making sure I don't take any of her gingerbread," Larry said.
Warren started laughing, his whole body shaking. I shook my head. "Well, Sheila means business," I said. "I look forward to seeing her at the competition. I'll just be glad when it's all over, Larry."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.